Modern architecture would be nowhere without one key ingredient in construction: cement. Cement is commonly used as a binder in concrete, and concrete is one of the critical materials used in all types of construction, from houses, schools, roads, hospitals, bridges, dams, you name it. Cement is also used in arts and crafts and decorative applications like sculptures and driveways. So, while the making of cement probably doesn't make for good dinner conversation, it's fun to know how something as integral to human development is manufactured. With that, let's take a look at how cement is made. First, let's learn a little about how cement came to be. The word cement can be traced back to the ancient Roman term opus cementitium, which was used to describe masonry made from crushed rock and a burnt lime binder, very similar to the cement we have today. Over the centuries, cement evolved to become the most widely used material in existence, just behind water as our most consumed resource. As we mentioned earlier, cement is the main ingredient in concrete. It serves as a binder for all other components in concrete, which are usually sand and gravel. When mixed with water, cement forms a paste that holds everything else in place when it hardens. That's why it's so essential in construction. Nobody wants to build a house without a solid adhesive binding everything together. It's essential to know that there are three processes in cement manufacturing, depending on how the raw materials are added to the kiln. The first process is the wet process, which involves grinding the raw materials wet and feeding them to the kiln as a slurry. The next process is the dry process, which involves grinding the raw materials dry and feeding them to the kiln as dry powder. The final process is the semi-dry process, involving grinding the raw materials dry and then moistening the mixture with water to form nodules that are then fed to the kiln. The chemical components of cement are calcium silicates and small amounts of calcium aluminates that cause the cement to set when it reacts with water. Manufacturers typically add 5% gypsum to the cement mixture to retard the setting time of the cement. However, the essential ingredients in cement are limestone, clay, and mudstone or shale, which provide silica and alumina. These raw materials are obtained from quarries, while other ingredients like iron ore and gypsum are obtained from mines. Cement producers like to locate their plants next to limestone deposits for ease of operation. However, not all limestone is suitable for cement production, as limestone found in different locations has different chemical components. Once these materials are procured, they're loaded onto hauling trucks that can hold up to 60 tons of raw materials. They can also be transported via railway freight cars, conveyor belts, or ropeways. Alternatively, the raw materials can be transported in a wet state or slurry via pipeline. Either way, the raw materials are transported to a crusher that breaks them into smaller bits without grinding them into powder. This happens at 600 tons per hour. Any soft material that needs to be added to the raw materials is first broken down by vigorous stirring with water in wash mills. This produces a fine slurry that's filtered by passing through screens to remove oversized particles. Once crushed, the raw materials head for the mixing bay, where they're mixed into a homogeneous material. This mixing bay is a huge structure with a radius of about 81 meters and a height of about 28 meters. First, an approximation of the chemical composition required for the cement is obtained by selective quarrying and control of the raw materials. Next, finer control is obtained by drawing from two or more batches of raw material mixtures with slightly different compositions. This allows the entire load of cement that will be produced to have the same quality and performance. For the wet process, the mixes are stored in slurry tanks. The slurry tanks are stirred mechanically, through compressed air, or both. During this process, the slurry, which contains 35 to 45% water, is sometimes filtered, reducing the water content to 20 to 30%. However, for the dry cement making process, these raw material mixes are stored in silos. In the silos, the raw materials get thoroughly mixed through agitation and rigorous circulation induced by compressed air. Next, a large blending machine that can crush up to 25,000 tons of mixed materials at once is used to crush the milled materials into a fine powder. However, before the powder can be ready for the next stage, the plant workers must ensure that all the raw materials are in the right proportion, as approved by the Industry Quality Control Department. If there are any discrepancies, a small proportion of corrective materials can be added to stabilize the mixture. The fine powder left after this process is called raw meal. The raw meal must now be preheated at about 900 degrees Celsius with hot gases from a kiln. This preheating process burns off any impurities in the raw meal and prepares it for the next stage, called pyroprocessing. Pyroprocessing is one of the hottest industrial processes, and it requires a tremendous amount of energy, traditionally in the form of fossil fuels. It involves placing the raw meal in a large rotary kiln at temperatures ranging from 1350 to 1500 degrees Celsius. These kilns are up to 200 meters long and 6 meters in diameter in wet process plants, but shorter in dry process plants. They're made of a steel cylindrical shell lined with refractory materials. The raw meal is fed into the kiln at the upper end, moving slowly down the kiln to the lower or firing end, rotating a slightly inclined axis. In the semi-dry process, the raw materials, in the form of nodules containing 10 to 15% water, are fed into a traveling chain grate that passes to a shorter rotary kiln. As the raw meal burns in the kiln, decarbonization begins, releasing chemical pollutants such as CO2. This process transforms the raw meal into a partially fused material called clinker. Modern kilns can produce about 5,000 tons of clinker daily. Although the pyro process is fundamental in cement making, it's costly and can harm the environment due to the release of chemicals. It's estimated that about 4 to 8% of the world's CO2 emissions come from the cement manufacturing process. Next is the cooling and grinding of the clinker. The clinker is first allowed to cool through an anti-quenching method in a giant cylindrical rotary cooler. When the clinker is cool, it's stored in a silo that can hold up to 55,000 tons of clinker. The next step is for the clinker to be ground into fine powder. During the grinding process, the clinker is laced with a small proportion of gypsum to provide a means of controlling the setting of the cement. The clinker is also extended with high-grade limestone. Limestone extension of the clinker helps reduce the carbon footprint of the final cement. The grinding takes place in a tube mill or ball mill, which is a rotating drum filled with steel balls of different sizes depending on the desired fineness of the cement. The steel balls crush and grind the clinker as the mill rotates. At this stage, the cement is ready. It's pumped pneumatically to storage silos, each of which has a capacity of 7,500 tons. During each step of the cement manufacturing process, cement plant laboratories carry out quality control checks by frequent chemical and physical tests. They also analyze and test the finished cement to ensure it complies with all industry specifications. With the cement done and tested, it's now ready to be packaged into 50-kilogram bags. The bags are placed on pallets with 40 bags per pallet. Each pallet gets shrink-wrapped for protection against the elements during the distribution process. When this is done, they're loaded onto trucks and sent to various destinations. Now, as you might have guessed, cement and water complement each other. In this regard, there are two types of cement, depending on its ability to set in the presence of water. We have hydraulic cement like Portland cement and the less common but equally effective non-hydraulic cement. Hydraulic cement works through a chemical reaction with dry ingredients and water that allows it to set and become an adhesive. The chemical reaction that takes place results in mineral hydrates that are not very water soluble, which makes them quite durable and immune to chemical attacks. So, hydraulic cement can set in wet conditions or even underwater without being vulnerable to chemical attacks. On the other hand, non-hydraulic cement cannot set in wet conditions or underwater. It's more suited to dry conditions because it sets as it dries while reacting with carbon dioxide in the air. However, once it sets, it's also resistant to chemical attack. With that, we now know just how much work goes into cement manufacturing. If you enjoyed this video, please like, share, and subscribe for more. Have you ever used cement in any personal project before? Share your experience in the comments.